Okay. Assalamualaikum and also good morning. Bagaimana tentang eksperimen satu yang kamu telah buat? Bila kamu plot the data dan sebagainya, kamu boleh faham tentang the data ataupun tidak? Bila kamu capture the data daripada encoder, okay, the data adalah data dalam bentuk position. Sebab encoder is measure the position based of the angles. Okay. Jadi the data is position. Dan bila you differentiate the position data, what happen to the data? Bila kamu differentiate the position data, apa akan jadi? Dia akan jadi velocity data. Okay? So that is the purpose. Sebab kita nak convert daripada position ke velocity. Okay? Jadi that's basically apa yang kita perlu lakukan. Okay. Tapi cuma masalah selepas itu kita ada gunakan yang satu lagi itu adalah 50 multiply by S divided by 50 plus S. Betul tak? Ada satu lagi filter. Okay, what happened? The input to your motor adalah voltage. Betul tak? Okay. And kita tahu bahawa the voltage is proportional to motor speed. Okay. Sebab tu bila kita nak compare the input dengan output, okay, yang mana kita kena jadikan the position data tu jadi motor speed. Okay. Bila kita gunakan differentiation. Okay. Jadi sekarang ni bila you ada input in the form of voltage which is proportional to speed, and then you ada the output daripada position tu, you convert into speed. Okay, so basically you akan ada pattern of the graph yang sama sepatutnya. Betul tak? Okay, walaupun in term of scaling mungkin dia lebih besar dan sebagainya, tapi basically the pattern should be the same. Yes. Okay. Tapi cuma bila kamu buat, yang mana kamu dapati after that differentiation, dia tak jadi square wave kan? Dia tak jadi square wave. That's the problem. Okay. Sebenarnya kenapa? Sebab dia ada noise. Okay. Sebab tu kita introduce yang satu lagi apa tu, yang kita kalikan dengan satu filter 50 kali S divided by 50 plus S. Okay. Sebenarnya yang S di atas itu adalah sama dengan derivatif. Okay. S yang di atas itu sama dengan derivatif. Tetapi yang 1 over S plus 50, that is filter. Okay, that is filter. Cuma yang kita kalikan 50 itu sebab kita the denumerator kita letakkan S plus 50, jadi kita nak elakkan the magnitude punya ni amplify. Atas tu kita letakkan 50 supaya the 50 yang atas tu akan cancel out dengan 50 di bawah. Okay, so the denumerator S plus 50 basically is a filter. Okay, the S yang dekat atas tu adalah derivative. Jadi kita combine derivative with filter. Okay. Jadi sebab tu kalau you paparkan graph daripada the filter tu, you akan dapati walaupun dia tak betul-betul square wave, tapi dia hampir kepada square wave. Right? Okay, sebab tu lain kali apabila kamu nak gunakan data daripada the actual macam tu, kita kena tambahkan the filter. Okay, supaya kita punya data correct. Semalam kita telah discuss in detail about phase lead design. Okay, jadi itu adalah satu method of the design selain daripada sebelum ni yang kita telah pelajari daripada chapter 7 parametric design dan juga the PID design. Okay, hari ini kita sentuh dua lagi. Okay, kalau sempat. Okay, kalau tak sempat kita sentuh dulu the integration networks. Dan selepas itu kita akan sentuh tentang fish-like design yang mana kedua-duanya menggunakan root locus method. Okay, in the books, kita cover section 10.6 dan juga section 10.7. Cuma, you can aware, one of the section kita skip sebab dia adalah berasaskan kepada frequency domain yang mana berkaitan dengan Bode diagram. Okay, phase lead using Bode diagram kita tak sentuh. Okay, integration networks. Okay, and especially the labs that you do this week basically related to integration networks. So you in the lab you will design this this is controller. Okay, the primary objective of control system in integration networks is to obtain a high steady state accuracy. Okay, basically when we introduce the integration networks, basically we wanted to have a high steady state accuracy. Okay, maksudnya kalau kita calculate the steady state error, the steady state error should equal to zero. We eliminate the error, the steady state error. Okay, and then to maintain the transient performance of the system within reasonable limits, the steady state accuracy of any feedback system can be increased by increasing the amplifier gain in the forward channel. If you, kalau kita ada satu sistem kawalan proportional, okay, yang mana kita just multiply the error tu dengan satu gain K, yang mana apabila you vary the value of the K, you boleh plot dia, plot the root locus of the K when the K is varying from 0 to infinity. Okay, and what you will notice, in fact this one will become the first exercise in the experiment this week. Okay, I think some of you have done yesterday. Okay, from the data you will realize that when you increasing the K, okay, when you put the value of the K low, you will find that the steady state error is very very high. Okay, the steady state error is very very high because you find that your final value won't reach to the value of 1. Okay, it is way below. Okay, but at that time you will see that there is no overshoot. Okay, the system just nicely become steady state. Okay, but when you increase the proportional gain, the K, okay, what you will notice that the steady state error will be reduced. Okay, so the final value will become closer and closer to the value of 1. Okay, but as you increase it, after some time you will notice that your overshoot start appearing. Okay, and then if you increase again the K, you will see that your final value will become nearer to the to value 1, where your steady state error become very very small. But now you notice that your overshoot will be very very high. Okay, and in fact if you try to make the final value equal to 1, okay, by increasing the K, you will notice that the percentage of overshoot sometimes will become very very high and sometimes will make the system become unstable. But for the case of in our experiment, okay, the system will not become unstable because if you look at the root locus, okay, without the compensator, okay, you will see that the root locus won't go to the unstable area. Okay, that's why it keep on increasing the value of percentage of overshoot. Okay, but it won't become unstable. But some system, if the root locus will move toward the unstable area, which is the right side of the imaginary axis, okay, then your system will become unstable when you increase the proportional gain very, very big. And with this system, okay, how much we adjust the K and how much we adjust the value of this K, either we increase or decrease, it is difficult to get the trade-off between in zero steady state error and also small overshoot. So however, the resultant transient response may be totally unacceptable or even unstable. So this means that when we keep on increasing, the percentage of overshoot will increase, getting bigger and bigger, and sometimes will become unstable. Therefore, it is often necessary to introduce a compensator network in forward part for a feedback control system in order to provide a sufficient steady state error, a steady state accuracy. Okay? Because that means if you your system have error, steady state error, that means your system is not accurate. Okay? Because you will never get your desired response. Okay? Because your output won't be equal to your desired response. Let's consider the single loop control system as shown here. Okay, this is the block diagram where we have the GS for the process, and then HS the feedback, and then GC is the your controller that you're going to introduce. GP is the pre-filter. Maybe we have a pre-filter here. Okay, so in this case, basically, we need to introduce a compensator here, cascade compensator, GC. Okay, so the compensator network is chosen to provide a large error constant. Okay, why we need a large error constant here? Can you recall back the when we learned the steady state error in chapter 5? When we have the tables, if we have the N type, 0, 1, 2, and then we have the different type of input, step input, ramp input, and parabolics. Because when you calculate the steady state error, it is either depend on the value of the N, it will become either 0, steady state error, or it will become infinity, or sometimes it become constant. Okay? And when it is become constant, okay, for for step input, basically the equation is the error is equal to A divided by 1 plus KP, right? Okay? That's for step input. For ramp input, you have steady state error equal to A divided by KV. Okay? And then for the parabolic input, you have the steady state error equal to A divided by KA. Okay? So that KP, KA, and KV is the error constant. So that means if we say that the error constant is large, what happened to the steady state error? Because all that error constant is denominator, right? Denumerator, okay? Since it is a denumerator, so the steady state error will become small if the error constant is big. Okay? That is the purpose, because normally if we cannot eliminate the steady state error, okay, at least we should try to make it to become small. So by increasing the error constant, basically we can and decrease the steady state error. Okay, make the steady state error small. Okay, let's say in this case we set the pre-filter equal to 1, and then the steady state error of the system will become this one. Okay, where if this one is become 1, so basically here we have GC multiplied by G. Okay, if we calculate the error, steady state error by taking the limit of t in approaching infinity for the function of error as a function of t. Okay, I think last time in chapter 5 we have done that. We got this equation. Okay, so RS is the input. Okay, and then we need to multiply with S and then divided by this thing. Okay, the only thing is that when we take limit S approaching 0, okay, all this will depend on the value of the function RS and the function of this one, GC multiplied by G multiplied by H. Okay, so the steady state error of a system depends on the number of pole at origin for this loop gain, this one, okay, GC multiplied by G multiplied by H. Okay, dependent on the S to the power of N that we have in that equation. Okay, a pole, okay, in the proportional plus integral controller, a pole at origin can be considered an integration. Okay, when we multiply by 1 over S, okay, that's basically we introducing a pole located at origin. Okay, and that is integration. Okay, therefore the steady state accuracy of a system ultimately depend on the number of the integration in the loop transfer function, because if you have enough integrator, basically it will cancel with the other S in the equation, and it will make your equation become zero. Okay, that's why that is important. If the steady state accuracy is not sufficient, an integration type of network GC will be introduced in order to compensate for the lack of integration in the uncompensated loop transfer function, G multiplied by H. Okay, I think later on if we look at the example, you will understand this statement. One widely used form of controller is the proportional plus integral controller, which has a transfer function like this. Okay, when we add the PI controller, okay, so basically in GC we add proportional, this the KP gain, okay, multiplied by error later on, okay, plus the KI multiplied by 1 over S. Okay, 1 over S is integral, and then multiply with the error. Okay, that's why this one is known as the integrals. Okay, this is known, this is the integral constant, this is the proportional constant. Okay, of course this equation we can rewrite. If we multiply this one with S, okay, we will have S divided by S. Okay, so we can have the KP multiplied by S plus KI divided by S. Okay, so the S underneath here basically will play important roles, because this one will add the number of the integral in the equation later on. Okay, because if in your process as transfer function G multiplied by H doesn't have enough this one, so when we add this one, basically it will add the integrator, which later on will make the system become zero. Okay, let's look at the example. This is temperature control system. where the transfer function, let's say HS is equal to 1, and the transfer function of the heat process is equal to GS, which equal to K1 divided by tau 1 multiplied by S plus 1 multiplied by tau 1, tau 2 multiplied by S plus 1. And the steady state error of the uncompensated system is this one. Okay, the only thing in this case, okay, this is the equation that we have just now for the steady state error. The only thing, we replace the RS with a step input, okay, and then we replace the HS equal to 1, okay, and then basically now we have the GS equal to this equation, okay. If we replace this here, okay, what will happen? S here and S here will cancel out, okay, and then you have this one here, okay. So this one is constant, this one is constant, and the GS basically this one is constant, okay, and then this one is a constant multiplied by S, but since the S is approaching zero, so this will become zero multiplied by tau 1 will become zero, plus 1 will become 1 only, okay. Same also here, tau 2 is a constant, S will approaching zero, okay, zero multiplied by tau 2 will become zero, plus 1 will become 1, so basically this one is 1 multiplied by 1, okay, and then K1 divided by 1 divided by 1, which equal to K1, okay, so we get that equation. So at the end we find that our steady state error will become a constant here. So this is the steady state error of the system when we are not introducing the compensator, okay, just based on the process and also the feedback. Basically from this equation what we can say that the steady state error is not zero, because A is a constant, divided by 1 is a constant, K1 is a constant, so basically at the end it become a constant, not zero, so there is a steady state error. So this is without the compensator. Okay, to obtain a small steady state error, okay, let's say less than 0.05A, for example, that means 5% of the step input, okay. Okay, in order to get that, the magnitude of the gain K1 must be quite large. Okay, this means we have to increase the value of the gain K1 to become very, very big. Okay, this means if we're talking about 0.05, this means 1 divided by 1 plus K1 should be equal to 0.05. And then from that, you find the value of the K1. Okay, and you will find that the value of the K1 will be very, very big. Okay, what is the answer should be K1? The K1 should be 99 divided by 5. What is that? Okay, so I think it is a quite big number. Okay, okay, and even that, even we have already get a small steady state error, but there is still error there. Okay, so that one, if we just play with the proportional control, okay, we play with the value of the gain K1. Okay, let's see how we can eliminate the steady state error by utilizing the proportional control, the PI controller. However, when K1 is quite large, the transient performance of the system will very likely to be unacceptable. Okay, let's say just now if you find the value of the K1, let's say the value of the K1 become 99 divided by 5. Okay, and then with that value, basically if you put in your transfer function, replace the value of the K1 with that value that you got, and now you plot the response of the system. Okay, you will find that the overshoot will be bigger. Okay, so that is the problem with the proportional control. Therefore, a PI compensation transfer function GC must be considered to eliminate the steady state error of this system. Okay, so we need to introduce the PI compensation transfer function GC. Okay, the steady state error for a step input of system is always zero. Okay, because okay, when we add the PI controller, okay, so the GC we add here, so the steady state equation will become like this. Okay, the difference is only that instead of only G function here, we have a GC here. Okay, you can start off from the initial transfer function with the value of the GC, and then you get the steady state error. At the end, you will get this equation. Okay, the only thing now, if we replace the GC with the equation of the transfer function of the PI, where KP multiplied by S plus K1 divided by S, okay, and then this one is the GC of the process, this is the G of the process, the transfer function of the process, and this is the step input. So you, what you will find here, the S here will cancel out with the S here, okay, and here the same thing, if S is approaching zero, this will become zero, and then plus 1, you get 1, this also will become 0 when S approaching 0, plus 1 will become 1, so this one will become same also as before, K1 divided by 1, right? However, for this side, what will happen? This one will become 0, multiplied by KP will become 0, plus with the KI will become KI, okay? The constant KI, and this one, if it is approaching zero, so this one will become zero. Okay, so now you have a K1, a KI multiplied by K1 divided by 1 divided by zero. What happened? It will become infinity. Okay, and when it will become infinity, if you add with 1 here, it will become infinity as well. Okay, and then here, A divided by infinity, basically you will find it will become 0. Okay, that's why when you add the PI controller here, okay, it can make your steady state error to become 0. Okay, that means it will eliminate the error. So basically your system will become accurate. Okay, there is no error at all. Okay, let's see an example. The uncompensated loop transfer function of the unity feedback temperature control system is equal to this one, Ts K1 divided by 2 multiplied by S plus 1 multiplied by 0.5 multiplied by S plus 1. The only thing, this equation, if you want to rewrite, you can rewrite. It become like this, S plus 0.5, and then here S plus 2, where we can adjust the value of the K1 as before, as in the proportional control. Okay, to maintain zero steady state error for a step input, we add the PI compensator network. Okay, so the PI compensator network is equal to KP plus KI divided by S, or we can write in this form KP multiplied by S, okay, plus KI. Okay, the only thing, because we factor out the KP, that's why this one here we need to divide with the KP, okay, and then divided by S. Okay, so basically this is a pole at origin, okay, and this is zero, where the location of the zero is basically the ratio between the KI and KP. Okay, furthermore, the transient response of the system is required to have an overshoot of less than 10%. So this is the design specification which is given. The percentage of overshoot should be less than 10%. Therefore, the dominant complex root must be on or below the line of zeta equal to 0.6. So actually this from this 10%, if you use the equation of the percentage of overshoot, which is equal to 100 multiplied by exponential of minus zeta pi divided by square root of 1 minus zeta square, okay, from that equation you will get the zeta should be equal to 0.6. okay, and then from this value of zeta you can find the value of theta. Okay, the theta is equal to r cos of 0.6, r cos of zeta. Okay, we should be equal to, what is that? If you have a calculator, you can calculate. Okay, so you have that angles. Okay, you can draw on your S plane. Okay, so the dominant complex root should be below that line. That means to this side of that line of angles, so that we can get a less than 10%. So this is the line. Okay, so if we calculate the theta here will become angle 180 minus 127. Okay, this is the angle of theta we will get if we calculate. So this is the line of that percentage of overshoot of 10%. Okay, so you can select anyone on this line or in this area, any point. Okay, so that's why we need to find the desired root location somewhere on that line or somewhere in this area, any place can be. Okay, and then after that, adjust the compensator zero so that the negative real part of the complex root is equal to the real part of the complex roots. That means what? Okay, let's say when we know the line of the area for the percentage of overshoot 10% is this one. Okay, you can find the, you can choose any point as your desired root, either on that line or somewhere in this area. Let's say if you pick this point, so basically it will fulfill the specification of 10%. Okay, the only thing, if you pick this point, basically you find that your real part will be negative 0.75 and your imaginary part is equal to 1 multiplied by j. So if you choose your desired root location here, which fulfill the specification, the next thing you need to find a location of 0, okay, somewhere below here, near to the location of this. If the real part of this desired root is 0.75, maybe somewhere you need to find the value somewhere near here. Okay, but it is not exactly there. The only thing this one say, if we select the zero somewhere there, because we will get the zeta multiplied by omega n is basically 0.75. If we substitute there, basically we will get our settling time around 16 over 3 seconds. And now, we need to determine the exact location of this zero. Okay? By ensuring that the angle of the desired root location is equal to negative 180 degree. Okay? So what we need to do, therefore the sum of the angle at the desired root is equal to this. Basically, you need to get exactly the position of this one. Okay? You need to do this. Okay? To use the angle criterion. Okay? Minus 100 degree should be equal to the angle to the poles from the roots. Okay? To the pole this one. Okay? Minus 127. Minus 104. Minus 38. Okay? This is all minus because of the pole. And then plus the angle of the zero, okay, to the roots, okay. So with this, you can calculate the angle theta z. Okay, if we calculate that, we will find that the theta z will be equal to plus 89 degree. Okay, so which is very very close to this real part, okay? Because if it is equal to that real part, basically it should be equal to 90 degree, but this one is only, the difference is only 1 degree, okay? And then from that, you can calculate the value of the z. Of course, it is slightly higher than 0.75 actually, okay? But if we round up, that value basically become 0.75. Okay, so now you get the position of the zero. And then finally, you need to determine the gain at the desired root. Okay, determine the gain at the desired root. And then evaluate the vector length from the pole and zero to obtain the value of K1 multiplied by Kp. Okay, you understand here, this equation? This is from the distance. Okay, this is the distance of the root to the three poles, pole number one, pole number two, pole number three, and then this is the distance of the zero. Because you have this one, right? You have the distance here, three poles, okay, and then divided the distance from the zero. Okay, so with that, basically you just insert the distance in this equation, and then now you get the K should be equal to 2.08. And this basically will equal to K1 multiplied by Kp. Okay? So the compensated root locus and the location of the zero are shown in the figure. So that is the figure. Okay. Now with the introduction of this one, okay, actually, if you plot the uncompensated root locus, you find that your root locus will be like this. This one will go 90 degree like that initially. But now when you add the PI here, PI compensator, okay, and when you design it to the dominant root should be here, okay, so the compensator will pull the root locus so that it will crossing your dominant roots, okay, it will crossing like that from initially vertical like that, okay, so that's how your PI controller will help, okay, reducing your steady state error, because now your root locus already changed. Note that the 0 should be placed to the left of the pole at S equal to negative 0.5 to ensure that the complex root dominate the transient response. Although the complex root dominate the transient response of the system, the equivalent damping of the system is somewhat less than 0.6 due to the real roots and the zero. So basically, the zero has a little bit effect on that. That's why the damping ratio will be reduced a little bit. So that's basically on the proportional plus integral controller. Okay. So the next slide is basically for the phase lag, which we cover maybe on Thursday. Any question on this? Okay. Jumpa lagi on Thursday.